name's Henry Lukas. I'm the education director at the Spellman Museum of Stamps and Postal History on the Regis College campus in Weston. And this is our monthly show. Turns out it's our 18th edition of a show that we connect postage stamps from the United States and around the world to famous historic events and birthdays of famous people born in the month, as well as some unusual celebrations that go on. So we'll be showing you these stamps and explaining a little connection with them. Why don't we start, though, I know probably by the time you're watching this, Groundhog Day is over, but the groundhog is a popular animal on stamps, so we salute the Punxsutawney Phil as well as all the other groundhogs out there. Wishing them hope they had a happy Groundhog Day. Also, we want to wish everybody a happy Chinese New Year. My understanding is this is the year of the dog, and you can see the latest United States stamp that's being issued this month. Features not only a dog up there in the upper, I believe, right-hand, left-hand corner, but also features the lucky bamboo sprouts. Bamboo is a popular house plant associated in many Asian countries with good luck. So that was chosen as the symbol this year. And I'm also showing you the last U.S. stamp that was issued in the last year of the dog. And even though this is the shortest month of the year, I think we have more activities going on at the museum this month. For example, on Saturday, February 10th from 11 to 3, you can see those dates on the screen, we'll be making Valentines using lots and lots of love stamps, making cards. We can send your Valentine cards. We'll provide free postage with those love stamps, as well as take some love stamps home. So please try to join us on February 10th. And then on Saturday, February 17th, we'll be having our Winter Olympics Family Day. We'll have lots of stamps displaying Winter Olympic sports from past issues. And we're hoping to actually have a Olympian, a Winter Olympian, visit us. Her name is Vicki Woodward, I believe from Sudbury. She visited us a couple years ago when we did our Summer Olympics program. Not only is she an Olympian, but she's actually appeared on a U.S. stamp. The stamp isn't about her, but she was the model for the Vermont stamp, which you can see on the screen. And also have a picture of her standing there with her carry bag. So hopefully she'll be here around 1 o'clock if you'd like to meet a real Olympian. And we'll be giving other news about the Olympics in Korea, which we also found out that there's a special stamp show on Korean, North Korean television. We're going to put the link up there. And if your Korean's pretty good, you might want to watch that show after you watch us. And then our third event will be on Thursday during the school vacation week, February 22nd. It's our annual Happy Birthday President's Day. It's a family day program again. Kids can make a collection of all the presidents that are on stamps, and we'll be saluting presidents, especially those born in February, which include William Henry Harrison was born on February 9th in 1773. A little earlier, George Washington was born on February 22nd, 1732. And my math teacher always told me that was easy to remember because that is the square root of 3. Abraham Lincoln was born, of course, on February 12th in 1807. And one of our most recent presidents, Ronald Reagan, born in Illinois on February 6th, 1911. So we wish all those presidents a happy birthday. And while doing this research for the president's birthday, I found out that it's very unusual. Last month we mentioned two presidents have the same date for birthdays. This month I found out that three of our current presidents were all born within 9 weeks of each other in 1946. Our current president, Mr. Trump, George W. Bush, and Bill Clinton, all born within 9 weeks in the same year. So those are our events, but getting back to Valentine's Day, I want to show you a bunch of love stamps, since the post office has issued almost 40 different love stamps since the first one appeared in 1973, which you can see on your screen. It was designed by the American artist Robert Indiana, and it was issued for special occasions, not just for Valentine's Day. And of course, the first day ceremony was in Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. It took another 9 years before the post office issued another love stamp, and that one came out, as you can see, with using flowers as the motif. And then a couple of more years went by, and Sister Coretta Kent published, her stamp was issued. Caused a little controversy. Many people didn't like it. But she was no stranger to controversy because I think we've mentioned this before on our show. She also did the artwork on the Dorchester gas tanks over there on the Southeast Expressway. And for those of you who remember, there was controversy about that artwork because one of the blue stripe coming down looked like a profile of Ho Chi Minh, and this was during the Vietnam War. When they repainted the tank, though, they kept it exactly the same. But that was her love stamp, and actually at the first day ceremony, they used it on the stage sound for Love Boat. Then the first dog to appear on a love stamp, you can see there, and the post office said they put the dog on to remind people of Charles Schulz's, the creator of Peanuts, who always said that happiness is a warm, warm puppy. A few more stamps came out, and then in 1991, during the height of the Persian Gulf War, this love stamp showing the whole world and using the theme, what the world needs now is love. The first lovebirds appeared on a 52-cent stamp, which was good if you were sending a heavier Valentine card, and that was issued then. And then a couple of years later, these two stamps appeared. These are called the putti. Putti is a term from the Renaissance time. But unfortunately, after the stamps were issued, the director of the National Gallery of Art told the post office that the putti actually are associated with death, not love. But that didn't stop the post office. They kept issuing them for a number of years. You'll also notice one of those stamps doesn't have a denomination on it. This is not uncommon with U.S. stamps because sometimes the stamps will be issued after the postal rate goes up, but the post office doesn't know what the new rate will be, so they printed without the denomination. The first love stamp to appear without the word love on it was this nice stamp, the 15th love stamp, and it's the swans facing each other. And then the following year, two more stamps came out, different shapes. One featured a Valentine greeting from an old German drawing, and the other one was using English paper lace from the Valentine, from the Victorian period. And then our first kind of advertising came on a stamp. In you can see these kisses from the Necco company right here in New England. You've often wondered what Necco wafers stood for. It's the New England Confectionery Company. And these two stamps that had I Love You, but they, as you know, they make probably over a billion of these heart stamps on Valentine's Day. And then a few years later, we had another commercial item, and that was the Hershey Kiss on its centennial anniversary, 100 years of kisses, came out in 2007, and this stamp was, again, quite popular. A little piece of trivia, and that is Mr. Hershey, who also appears on a stamp, as you can see, was supposed to be on the Titanic with his wife. She got ill, and they chose a later voyage, and so he survived, obviously. But if he hadn't, we might not have had Hershey Kisses. And if you're old enough to remember being around in World War II, you'll remember you couldn't find any Hershey Kisses because the aluminum foil was all being used in the war effort. And then one last stamp, the Lovebirds. This was a very pretty stamp that came out in 2006. They're blue Lovebirds. And it turns out that the expression of the phrase true as blue or true blue comes from Old England, when the phrase true as Coventry blue, which was the color that they used there to show love. So those are our love stamps. And again, I have one little trivia question. If you'd like to get some free love stamps, I'm going to show you a stamp here, and I want you to tell me what type of writing was invented either in 1915 in America or possibly in 1919 that appears on this stamp. So if you know the answer to that new type of writing that appeared in around 1915, send us an email, and we'll send you some love stamps. All right, let's move on to the holidays in February. February is American Heart Month. Last month was American Donate Blood Month. This year it's American Heart Month. This is also National Cherry Month. You can see a bunch of stamps with cherries on them, including a few that have the very beautiful cherry blossoms down in Washington, D.C. And as you may not know, the first cherry blossom trees appeared in Washington as a gift from Tokyo, Japan, through the arrangement of Mrs. Taft, President Taft's wife. Also, February is National Children's Dental Health Month. You can see an old stamp from, I believe, the early 60s celebrating that. And it's also National Grapefruit Month. And for those of you who are on those anti cholesterol pills. You know that you haven't had a grapefruit in quite a while. But those are some, one other I forgot. This is also An Affair to Remember Month. This celebrates that wonderful romantic movie with Cary Grant and Deborah Kerr, or is it Carr, where they're supposed to meet at the top of the Empire State Building. And of course, she has an accident and doesn't make it. It was also featured in the movie Sleepless in Seattle. But we throw this in because Cary Grant's on a stamp and also the Empire State Building. So those are some of our holidays. A couple of interesting stamps in February. February 20th, 1962, the most secret stamp ever issued. It was in honor of John Glenn going around the Earth. He was supposed to go around 7 or 8 times. Had some trouble and had to come back. They wanted to print a stamp to honor his trip, but of course they couldn't issue it if he unfortunately didn't make it back. So they put a printing press, a new type of printing press, inside a very secret room, told very few people what they were doing. They had a guard outside, and they printed up this stamp that you see, but they did not issue it until 3:30 on the day of February 20th, when John Glenn had landed and was safe. Then they sent a telegram out to all the post offices that had this top secret stamp, and the stamp was issued. But it did make some first day covers difficult because it was issued so late in the day. John Glenn probably will be on a stamp pretty soon since he has passed away, and you can see some other countries have recognized him. Let's talk a little bit about the Boy Scouts and their connection with Norman Rockwell. Norman Rockwell was born on February 8th, 1910. I'm sorry, he was born on February 3rd, 1894. The Boy Scouts were founded on February 8, 1910, in the United States. They had been founded a few years earlier in England. But anyway, the connection between Norman Rockwell and the Boy Scouts is he illustrated their calendars for every year between 1924 and 1975, all but two of those years. And because he was such a fan of the Boy Scouts, he even designed that Boy Scout stamp that you see in front of you on the screen. He actually painted that. It was a 14-year-old boy. Name was Thornton Percival, and he lived in Stockbridge. He came over to Rockwell's studio, and Rockwell painted him. Rockwell forgot, however, that Thornton was not even a Boy Scout. But that became a very popular stamp. They printed almost 140 million of them. And then Norman Rockwell was asked to design some other U.S. stamps, including the ones I'm going to show you here. In addition to that Boy Scout stamp in 1960, he did the City Mail Delivery stamp, he did the Tom Sawyer stamp, and a stamp honoring the Peace Corps, which was part of the Century Series. So Norman Rockwell has quite a connection, not only with the Boy Scouts, but with the post office. And let's just look at a couple of other important quick dates from some famous people. We have John Ford, who was born in Cape Elizabeth, Maine, who did the directing of the movie The Grapes of Wrath with Henry Fonda. Famous story about the sinking of the Dorchester, USS Dorchester, that was sunk right at the beginning of World War II, where 4 chaplains gave up their life jackets and drowned while they were able to save the lives of 4 people. First female physician, Elizabeth Blackwell, was born in 1821 on February 3rd. She set up a hospital in New York City with an all-female staff. If you like Snow White, the Walt Disney movie, it was released on February 4th in 1938. Wish happy birthday to Massachusetts. This is our became a state on February 6th, 1788. And Thomas Edison, want to wish him a happy birthday. He was born in Milan, Ohio, on February 11th, 1847. So that's about, we got lots and lots of more dates. If you'd like to get one of our calendars, please email to us. Don't forget to email that your answer to what type of writing was used and shown on that stamp. And we hope you get to come to the museum for any of our or all of our family days. Again, the dates are on the screen. And mention that you saw the show, and we'll give you a nice reduced admission. So thank you for watching, and we welcome any comments. Send us a letter or an email, and we'll get back to you.